And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Will you please turn with me to the screen?
Some of the best stories, places become more than just backdrops for the action. They become characters themselves. Unyielding mountains, unpredictable seas. And in the story of Christmas, a tiny town that birthed Israel's greatest king, and the king who was yet to reign. David's birthplace was so insignificant that it could easily have been lost to history, swallowed up by Jerusalem just 5 miles away. But God made a promise to this little town through Micah, the prophet. Bethlehem, God said, you are smaller than most of the towns in Judah, but from you will come for me. A ruler over Israel. So little Bethlehem waited, ready for the birth of her second king, the promised one of God.
Melissa's going to light the Bethlehem candle, the second candle of Advent. The lighting of this candle symbolizes God keeping his promise of a Savior who would be born in Bethlehem. Caesar Augustus was the ruler of the Roman Empire, and he called for a census to be taken throughout the empire. But though Augustus thought he was in charge, God really was in charge. For he used Caesar's decree to bring about the fulfillment of prophecy spoken of in Micah 5:2. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is, to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. Caesar's edict caused Mary and Joseph to travel 80 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem to register under the new law to fulfill the word of God. As we draw near to the birth of Jesus, we begin to see just how specific God was about giving his people directions to the main event. I think that's important for us to understand as well today, that God gives us directions to the main event. The Micah 5 prophecy was written 735 years before the birth of Christ, and yet it's as specific as if it were spoken on the day Christ was born.
Ever.
Will you please bow your head? Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this day to light the candle which points the way you have directed us to go. Since the beginning of time, you have wanted only the very best for us. The life we live now is not the life you originally intended for your creation to live. Though out of the history of mankind, you have been the one we look to point the true and correct way. And when we have not had the courage to follow the way of your leading, you sent someone into the world, like John the Baptist, to point the way, though it means his very life. These are tough and confusing times as well. With all that pulls us in different directions, all the pleasures and technology at our disposal, we find ourselves with so much before us that has never existed before. With each new day, we find ourselves and our beliefs and your teachings under attack. Everything around us pulls us away from you. You sent John the Baptist into the wilderness with nothing but the message to repent and follow the one, Jesus Christ, who came after him. Help us to learn to have the courage of our fathers and mothers. Point the way and give us the courage to follow. For it's in the name of our precious and our great Lord Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Will you please turn with me on our screen as we go to our responsive reading in Psalms 129, 9 through 11. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea,
even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me.
If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me,
even the night shall be light about me.
Amen. Bless the reading of God's word. Our praise hymn this morning, He Included Me.
Included me, yes, He included me when
Isn't that wonderful that we know that we have been included? We haven't been excluded. Some may call us a basket of deplorables, but we've been included and can't be removed. Our second hymn this morning is, O Come All Ye Faithful.
Joyful and triumphant, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold Him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore Him. O come, let us adore Him. O come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord.
Sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation, sing all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest.
Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. To Thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him.
Well, what month is it anyway?
December.
It's December. Oh, okay. December. That's right. We have communion out here this morning, so I want everybody to start thinking. And because it's December, and it's the first, we have what? A new memory verse from Romans 15:7. Wherefore, receive ye one another, as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Romans 15:7.
Wherefore ye receive ye one another, as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Romans 15:7.
Amen. All right, good. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you this morning. We had Boy, it's been a full week, and I think our weeks are going to continue to be full as possible. We had our Thanksgiving Christmas dinner yesterday here at the church. We had the place was full. We went through lots of food and had a wonderful time. Well, it's good to see all of you that are here this morning, and especially those that are watching from home. I think if you look around, you'll see that we've decorated the church a little bit, and we decided that our puppets kids wanted to get out here. There are cardiac kids down on the farm, cardiac kids, and I'm going to introduce them because we have lots of fun with the. With the kids and the puppets every once a month. We bring them out, and we have a birthday party for all the kids of that month. And by the way, if you want to be a character, we're looking for characters, people who want to be puzzled. But on the bottom from my far left would be a Rainbow, and then Michael. And then
Joey.
And then Mrs. Buttons up there at the top, and Butch, and Angelica, and who's the other one?
Confused.
Who's the other one?
Confused.
Who's your favorite up there? I think Confused is the favorite of all of the kids, because a lot of the plays are written around and Confused is confused, but he's like one of the other kids. He gets things confused, but we get him straightened out by the end of the play, and the kids have a great time with the puppets up there. It's a wonderful time. And like I said, if you want to be a puppet, we're looking. Oh, I think I forgot the alligator is in the back there, up next to Mrs. Buttons, and we have the big bird. We haven't used that bird in the play yet, and we're gonna have. Probably have a contest to see what kind of name we name it, and the little bees. So, and then we're going to have puppets next Saturday at 11 to 2. So everyone show up. I know we have some kids with birthdays in December, so they all want to be here for their birthday party. And then we'll continue to have Kid Fusion on Thursdays, right up through Christmas. We're not gonna miss any time, because we've got our kids program on the 16th. So we got to get the kids going for that, ready for that, and want to make sure that everybody knows that on Christmas Eve, 7 o'clock Christmas Eve, we're going to be here, and we're going to have a Christmas Eve service, a candle lighting ceremony, and then followed by the giving of gifts, and we'll have a great time. Also, I want to make sure that you know that we're still adopting families. If we have kids or families that need some help over Christmas, we have some places available, and we're still adopting some kids for Christmas. As a matter of fact, if you see the tree up on that's the first year we've put the tree up, because last year we nearly buried the tree, and it might get that way again this year. So the Christmas is a great time. We enjoy Christmas so much because Christ has given us so much in our life that it's you know, impossible for us to go through Christmas without feeling that joy, that need to give for all that He's given us. Just make sure if you do have somebody that you want to call us about for adopting, you can call the bottom number, 827-3275. That's Sarah's. And if you want to call here at the church, it's 967-3628. And if you want to send this to somebody else on the internet, that you'll be seeing us on the internet. You can go to www.oilregionlive.com and find us there. And as always, we want to thank Luke and Chris and Mark and all the good people at the stream and Armstrong Cable for helping us make this program available to all of you. I think that what we're going to do this year, something different than we've done in the past, since we're on Sunday evenings and Wednesday mornings, is Sunday evening this year we'll broadcast our Christmas Eve service, and then on Wednesday morning we'll broadcast our Sunday service. Bible study Tuesday at 6:30, and we're going through the book of Acts, and we're having some really, really good discussions through there. Anything else I forgot coming up, going on? Don't forget the kids program, the 12th, Christmas Eve, and puppets, and all kinds of stuff going on. All right. Anyone have a praise this morning? Yeah. I know Sarah's in the back with the smaller kids, but she was coming here to help decorate the church on Wednesday, she was coming up 408 where the road, where there's a bank, high bank on the road, and a deer jumped off the bank right onto the top of her car, went right through her windshield and crushed, and didn't do anything to the front or the side of the car, so he had to be an airborne one. And so, but we're thankful that her car wasn't totaled and she wasn't hurt. But anyone else this morning? I'm thankful for yesterday that we had a great group of kids and people here yesterday and had a wonderful time. And I know several people were out hunting yesterday, but I didn't hear anybody got anything. They saw some things, but so anyone else have a praise this morning? Yes, Mike.
My grandma's getting surgery on her hip.
You want prayer for your grandma? Okay. All right. Anyone else? Sarah.
The Madison and his guys placed yesterday at their Lego competition.
Say again what?
That Madison's Pleasantville team placed at the Lego competition.
All right. You did. Okay. Good for you. That's a really good praise. Anyone else have a praise? Yes.
My cousin?
You want prayer for your cousin? Okay.
And my pet. I have seven pets that died and three dogs that died.
All right. Anyone else have a prayer request? Yes.
My aunt, right now, her boyfriend passed away.
Uh-huh. Okay. Pray for your aunt. Okay. Anyone else this morning? Everyone, okay.
My grandpa Vince.
Huh?
My grandpa Vince.
Vince? Okay. Gene?
I'd like to praise God for all the parents that showed up yesterday.
Yes, uh-huh. Yeah, we had a lot of
surprise
good...
how much quieter that bus is when there's a couple parents riding.
Yeah, right. That's a fact. All right. Alicia's grandmother. Anyone else this morning have a prayer request? Rod, we want to keep you in prayer for your foot, and Ron for your eye, and the Schaefer family. All right, and as we get ready to go for prayer, remember we'll have communion service directly after. So also keep your mind thinking about our communion and your life with the Lord. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us the ability to come boldly before the throne of grace. We thank you for all the many, many blessings that we pour out around you, or you pour out around us. We thank you for the love that you show us day by day. We love that you have included us and you have made us all a whosoever, and we all have a place that is permanently guaranteed. We thank you for all the things that you have done. and all the things that you will do. We thank you for our kids and their parents, and we thank you for our families that work so hard and do so much here at the church. We thank you for each and every person that comes to worship. We ask you to be with several grandmas and grandpas here and an aunt. And Lord, we ask you to be with Rod as he goes this week to the hospital to check on getting some relief with his eye. We ask you to be with Rod and his foot. And we ask you to continue to be with the Schaefer family. We ask you to watch over this country and help us to come together as a nation. We ask you to help us to be the Christian nation that we need to be, that will spread the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the world. We truly need to be a nation that respects our police and our firemen and all the people that are in uniform, including our military. And we ask you to be with them and their families, as many that serve in the military will be away from their families this Christmas. We just ask you to help this church continue to grow. Bless us and help us to continue to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask all these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I think thinking about communion and the birth of Christ at Christmas time is something that's truly wonderful to realize that how much our Lord means to us all. The coming together as a family. Jesus Christ sat with his disciples, and they were his immediate family at the time. Now, you are all part of his family as well. And as a result, around the world, we take communion to continue to show that we're connected with one another. Jesus sat at the table knowing that he was going to be broken and tortured and beaten. But he went and he did it anyway. Do you think anybody could love you that much, Mike? Huh? To go through what Jesus went through for you? But he did, right? Yeah. It's hard to imagine all the things that he went through. He was sinless. He was perfect. He didn't do anything wrong. Yet he was the one that paid the price for each of us. I thank God for even having the idea. If God didn't have the idea, we wouldn't be going through this. But he had the idea to send his only son to die for each of us. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us. And we thank you for your son who allowed himself to be broken and beaten for each and every one of us.
the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. The job would have only been half done, because God demanded that blood be shed for the forgiveness of our sins. And that perfect Lamb who allowed himself to be broken and beaten for us shed all of his blood for us. Many writers said that when Jesus hung on the cross and they pierced his side, there wasn't any blood left in his body. That he had shed all of his blood for each and every one of us. Father, we thank you that Jesus was faithful to the cross. We thank you that our Lord is sitting beside you, that you have raised him from the dead, that you have given him a glorified body, and that he is in heaven preparing a place for us, that we may be together for all eternity. One of the most marvelous and wonderful times of our Christian life is when we come together in communion, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Lonely plains, they depend on us.
Our scripture this morning is from Matthew 3, 1 through 6. Matthew 3, 1 through 6, if you have a Bible. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye a way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region around about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. John was the son of a priest named Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth, and was born about 6 months before Jesus Christ. And the story of Zacharias and Elizabeth is a wonderful story, some paralleling a little bit of Sarah's story. But he came preaching, John did, proclaiming as a herald a matter of great and solemn importance to men. The subject not his own, not of himself, but the message came from God. John alone received this message and his commission from God. The prophet Malachi had said that the messenger would come ahead to prepare the way for the coming of the king. He says, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me." John the Baptist made it very clear that he was just the messenger, and Matthew is making that clear. Therefore, he walks out on the pages of Scripture, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Repent is an expression that always has been given to God's people as a challenge to turn around. Repent in the original Greek is metanoia, meaning to change your mind. You are going in one direction, turn around and go in another direction. The sinner is led to understand that the way he has walked has been in the way of misery, death, and hell. It can mean that the sinner has been walking in madness, which suggests that the whole life of the sinner is nothing more than a continued course of madness and folly, living in a constant opposition to all the dictates of true wisdom, to wage war against one's own best interest in time and eternity. It means that the sinner is provoking and insulting the living God. His habitual sin prepares himself only for a state of misery and insanity, which every sinner exhibits often and plentifully. It was from this notion of the word that the Latins termed repentance to mean to grow wise again. Repentance then implies that the measure of divine wisdom is communicated to the sinner, and that he thereby becomes wise to salvation, that his mind, purposes, opinions, and inclinations are changed, and that in consequence there is a total change in his conduct. Therefore, a person who truly repents realizes he has sinned against God, and therefore he becomes truly sorrowful, not only because it has been ruinous to his own soul, but because it has been offensive to God. These are the people who, when they become cold and indifferent, are to turn. That was the message to the seven churches in Asia Minor in Revelations 2 and 3. And it was the message of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. The unsaved man is told that he is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when an unsaved man believes in Jesus, he is repenting. Faith means to turn to Christ. And when you turn to Christ, you must also turn away from something else. If you don't turn from something, then you really aren't turning to Christ. So repentance is really a part of believing. But the primary message that should be given to the lost today is that they should believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The expression kingdom of heaven means the rule of the heavens over the earth. The kingdom of heaven is at hand, referring to the prophecy of Daniel, where the reign of Christ among men is expressly foretold. I saw in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Then was written in Daniel hundreds and hundreds of years before Christ came to earth. But why is this called a kingdom? It is called a kingdom because it has its laws. The moral precepts are grounded in the gospel and in biblical messages. It has a king, and it has subjects, all of who believe in Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus is the king. You can't have a kingdom without a king. Neither can you have a king without a kingdom. Remember Richard III, who said in a Shakespearean play, "My kingdom for a horse." If he had traded his kingdom for a horse, he wouldn't have been a king anymore. He would have been only a man on horseback. A king must have a kingdom. So what did John the Baptist mean by the kingdom of heaven is at hand? He meant that the kingdom of heaven is present in the person of the king. The kingdom of heaven is not meat and drink. We find in Romans, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost." Is there a present reality of the kingdom of heaven? Yes, there is. Those who come to Christ as Savior and acknowledge him are translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. They belong to him now, and they have a much more intimate relationship than that of a subject with a king. Christ is the bridegroom, and believers are part of his bride. And all this is possible by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ to enjoy here on earth. It is further added, this kingdom is at hand. God will bring this kingdom into being. So therefore, we are much better off to accept this phrase as if it were already present in our lives. Because as God commanded it will be, without exception or even the slightest change. Then someone may ask whether we are like subjects in a kingdom because we are to carry out his commands. Again, I say, there is more to it than that. We are to obey him because we love him. It is a love relationship. If you love me, keep my commandments, Jesus says. The kingdom of heaven is the rule of the heavens over the earth. Christ is not reigning today in any shape or form or fashion, except in the hearts of those who have received him. However, he was coming someday to establish his kingdom here on earth. And when he does, he will put down all rebellion. The kingdom of heaven was at hand in John's time and is present in our time and is present in the person of the king. Matthew now tells us that what he is recording is in fulfillment of prophecy. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye a way of the Lord, make his path straight." The prophet Isaiah, in many of the Bibles written, is Isaiah. And the prophecy is in Isaiah 43, the voice of one crying in the wilderness. All that John the Baptist claimed for himself was that he was a voice crying in the wilderness, and his purpose was to prepare the way of the Lord. The idea is taken from the practice of Eastern monarchs, who, whenever they entered upon an expedition or took a journey through a desert country, sent harbingers before them to prepare all things for their passage. They sent pioneers to open the passage, to level the ways, and to remove all impediments. The officers appointed to superintend such preparations were called by the Latins staretors. Diodorus, who was an ancient historian, wrote and makes an accounting of the march of Semiramis into Media and Persia. And that's a clear, this is a clear example of what I'm trying to explain. In her march to Ecbatane, she came to the Zacharian Mountains, which extended many furlongs, and being full of craggy precipices and deep hollows, could not be passed without making a great detour around. Being therefore desirous of leaving an everlasting memorial of herself as well as shortening the way, she ordered the precipices to be digged down and the hollows to be filled up. And at a great expense, she made a shorter and more expeditious route, which to this day is called for her in Iran, the road of Semiramis. She prepared the way, or the way was prepared for her, just as John. The condition of Judaism at the time of John the Baptist was that of a desert country. That's why John was out in the desert. It was sparse, it was barren, it was dry. There was no greenery. So John was out in the desert to represent what the relationship between God and the Israelites at that time. It was destitute of all religious cultivation and of the spirit and practice of godliness. And John was sent to prepare the way of the Lord by preaching the doctrine of repentance. John needed to preach it because it did not any longer exist in all of Judea. And the same John had his raiment of camel hair and a leather girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. His raiment was of camel's hair, a raiment common to the prophets. In such a garment we find Elijah. His leather girdle was about his loins. His meat was locusts and wild honey. We're told that he never shaved and had long hair.
He probably wouldn't be allowed to be in most churches today. Here's an unusual man, a man with a mission. He's really an Old Testament character walking out of the Old Testament onto the pages of the New Testament. He is the last of the Old Testament prophets. Remember, it had been 400 years since the last prophet. Then went out of him Jerusalem and all of Judea and all the region round about Jordan. Notice that the crowds went out to him. John did not rent a stadium or an auditorium or a church, and there was no committee that invited him. If you wanted to hear John, you went out to where he was. Obviously, the Spirit of God was on this man. And were baptized of him in the Jordan, confessing their sins, Matthew tells us. In other words, all of this denoted a change in the lives of these people. The very fact that they submitted to John's baptism was an indication that they were leaving their old lives and turning to new lives. Confessing their sins indicates that they earnestly acknowledged that their sins were their own. They took the whole and complete blame. They didn't make it someone else's fault. They didn't pass the buck onto genetics or the way we were raised. They took the whole blame upon themselves, laying nothing to the charge of God or man. This is essential to true repentance. And till a man or woman take the whole blame, he or she cannot feel the absolute need for the mercy of God or the necessity to be saved. This week, our Advent theme is pointing away. As a church, we've struggled over the last 5 years to point the way that is supposed to be pointed, the way to Jesus Christ, the way to a good living, the way to living a way that would be pleasing to our Lord Jesus Christ. It's not easy to be pointing the way. It wasn't easy for John the Baptist, and it hasn't been easy for the church. It certainly hasn't been easy for us here being the church to be pointing the way. But little by little, people are hearing the gospel. People are changing their lives. Around you, people are repenting. If you're watching it at home, this Christmas time is a perfect time to come to the Lord Jesus Christ, to repent of your sins, ask him into your heart. There truly can't be any more wonderful gift than the gift that we have received from him and from our God. I know that this time of year, many people struggle with depression, and that is because they're empty, because they're hollow. We just went through Thanksgiving. What a wonderful time. What a wonderful time to be thankful for. To be thankful for God. But I can imagine through all the years of counseling that I've done that many people are not thankful for anything because they don't have Christ in their life. They don't have God in their life. And it's hard for them to have the love that I see you people have for your children and your grandchildren, and the love that abounds in this church. There is a great love here that overflows and fills this place up. Sometimes we get wore down. I guess that's why John ate locusts and honey, two foods that were very rich in protein and energy. Because it takes a lot to preach that we have to repent. We have to change our way. Jesus Christ, born in Bethlehem, is there. Is not there today, but was born there to point the way point the way to a wonderful place that we read about in Revelation, a wonderful place that we will have, that Jesus Christ is preparing for us. One day, we will all be together in heaven with our Lord. We must all repent and come to God as repentant sinners. There's no other way. Some places and some people want to come to God without repentance. But John tells us that's not the way. Our hymn of dedication this morning is Angels We Have Heard on High. Ushers, please come for our tithes and offerings. You know, when I was thinking of that song, I was thinking of all the beautiful things that we have in the world because of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. The most beautiful music that there is. Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, you have given us all things, including our salvation. You have made things, all things around us wonderful. And you're always there to watch over us. We ask you to bless this offering, to bless each and every person here, all of those who struggle and work and do so much at this church. We ask you to bless, keep your hand upon each and every one as we go upon our way this week. to guide us and lead us and keep us safe, to take us to the doctors and back again and give us the healing that we need. We ask you to be with our cars and our homes and all that we have. We ask you to be especially with our children, to watch over them and their parents and grandparents and all the teachers and everyone who provides care and instruction. Watch over them as well. Give us the ability to live our lives that's pleasing to you and that attracts others to us. Give us the opportunity to witness to someone, to invite someone to church next week, to share the wonder, the glory, the greatness of your birth and your death and your resurrection. All these things we ask in the name of our precious Lord and Savior. We pray. Amen.